Now it is my privilege to introduce you our guest speaker this morning. How many of you guys were at the men's conference? So you've already heard our guest speaker this morning, Dr. Pastor Esquire Chris Johnson, the senior sir. You and Seth both have so many titles. But Chris is the senior pastor of Divine Unity Community Church in Harrisonburg, Virginia. He was a football player at Bridgewater College. And then we heard last night was he just went around to all of the Bible studies in the area. And then he started his own one, which was called Do-Rag. And then that turned into Divine. You don't need a do-rag anymore. And so now it's Divine Unity Community Church. Chris is an incredible man of God, an incredible husband, a father to three. He's going to show you a picture of his kids in just a little bit. And over the last couple of years, we've gotten to be really good friends. We've actually advanced our friendship to Instagram Reels. And so we're in a real relationship there. You get to see how things go right there. If you've already heard, Chris is an incredibly powerful and dynamic speaker. He's just a man who is overwhelmed with the presence of God, with the Word of God. And when we're thinking about our Build Conference, between bringing in Pastor Seth this past weekend and bringing in Pastor Chris, yes, these gentlemen are good friends of mine, but I believe that they are absolutely huge blessings to you, TNLC. So please join me in welcoming Pastor Chris Johnson to the stage. We'll dap it up right there. We go.
Amen, amen. Oh, man, can we just make a big praise to God for a moment real quick? Can we give God some praise in the place? Come on. I am so delighted to be here at TNLC. If I got the acronym right, I did. Okay. I normally have a three-letter limit. It's increase while we're here. And I want to give you just a glimpse of my family real quick. They are all here. This is the CJ squad. And all of us, all of our names start with C. And bless the name of the Lord. All of us have the same last name. But we have my lovely bride, Sherelle, who's up front here. Wave your hand back. And we have our pretty mini, Chloe, who is a preteen. And so she's 11. We have Chip, which is Christopher Mark Johnson Jr. And this is their real personalities. Chip, Christopher Mark Johnson Jr., he's 8. And then we have Caleb, which is our ball of joy. The last one, his middle name is Zachariah, starts with Z, which means there's no more coming after him. And he is 4. I love it when people look at you and say, are you having any more? Some people looked at us, they said, hey, are you guys getting a dog? I said, no, we have a Caleb. And in Hebrew, that means dog. And we have enough time cleaning up after him. But we absolutely love our children and love our family. And for your lead pastors, Clayton and Kelly, can y'all just show them some love real quick? Let them know that you appreciate them. They're just amazing, doing many, many years of ministry, and they have not aged for 25 years. The only time you know Clayton has got a little bit older, you see a little bit of gray in his beard. But I was looking, I was doing a pre-service moment, we were sound checking. And I said, am I envious of his hair follicles? They're just so bountiful and perfectly placed. I went natural a few years ago. We got married in 2011, planted the church 2012 in like 6 months, had a child in 2013, and I think the Lord says something got to go. There's a word from the Lord today. And I'm excited to be able to share with you greetings from Divine Unity Community Church. We are part of the Every Nation family as well. So we're so delighted to just be able to be in spiritual family. Let's go to Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 through 38. Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 through 38. And we'll be in the New King James Version. And this is one of my favorite passages in Scripture. And my hope is today that this would be an encouragement, maybe ignite something in some people, maybe fan the flame in others. Also, may we feel the invitation to be a small part of God's big plan. Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 through 38. And this is the word of the Lord. It says, then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them, because they were weary and scattered like sheep having no shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. I want to go back to verse 37. The harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. I want to use for a title, topic, subject, and focus for my moments with you. Simply this, sent ones, his heart, his people, our participation. Sent ones, his heart, his people, our participation. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor. Okay, that was very bad. All right, look at your neighbor. Let's try this again. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor. Participation. Is better than observation. All right, look at your other neighbor, your second favorite neighbor. Say, second favorite neighbor. I just didn't want you to feel left out. Sent ones, let us pray. Father, we thank you so much for who you are. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity and this space and this place, both in the natural as well as in the spiritual. As we have come here today, God, it is my hope that we will be able to hear from you, that you will give us a greater understanding of who you are, your will, your mission, and our role within it. God, I pray now, Lord, that this will be a moment that eyes will be open, that ears will be open to hear your word, that people's hearts who may be hardened will be softened, people's hearts who are broken will be healed. Lord, that we will be able to have a greater sense of why you have created us and how we can maximize this time here on earth. Lord, I pray, even as I preach, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen. Sent ones, his heart, his people, our participation. It has been said that the two most important days of your life are the day you were born and the day you found out why. The day you were born, pretty significant. That's when your life here on earth starts. That's when you take your breath, first breath out of the womb. It's the day that essentially there's a new book of life that has been opened, and now you have the opportunity of a lifetime. Y'all get it? And if you do it right, the benefits are out of this world. Y'all get it? Okay, I just want to see where y'all at. But the second day, most important day, is the day you find out why. It's not enough just to breathe air. You got to maximize the air you breathe, and I'm not just talking about oxygen levels. Even if you think about the day you find out why, it was reported, it was researched and reported that typically at conferences where there's self-help or anything about advancement or people doing something, the sessions on purpose are the most attended sessions because everybody's trying to figure out, why am I here on earth? Rick Warren, in his book, Purpose Driven Life, even rebranded his book to talk about what am I on earth for? Because many of us are living with this existential question, why am I here? I know every now and then you might do something that you feel completely fulfilled and you say, wow, this is why I am here. Some of us may have been having fun one day and it was so fun. You thought, this is why I'm here. Has anybody ever felt that on a roller coaster? You're going all the way up, you're coming out, this is why I'm on earth. You might feel that's how life feels, but that's not typically, you're like, all right, I'm on here. So anyway, but some of us, you have been able to serve people And you felt this overwhelming sense of satisfaction that had nothing to do with your socioeconomic status or your education level. You felt like this is what life is for. Some of those who are about to go on the missions trip, whether it be Cuba or Wales, they're going to have a moment while they're there that they're going to say, I've never experienced something like this. What I realized, every time you think you got to purpose, there's still more to discover. And here's the thing, you get a slice of it. It's like the best pie ever, purpose pie. That's what I'm gonna name it today. It's like you get a slice of it. And like, this is so good. How many of us have eaten more food, even though you're a fool, just because it tastes good? Good. I just wanted to know if there were some other foodies in the house. Most of my repentance and regrets come from that right there. It tastes so good, I gotta get more. I'm gonna roll myself to the kitchen. But oftentimes when you get a slice of purpose in your life, it begins to change your priorities as well. It'll change how you spend your time. It'll change how you spend your money. It'll change how you relate with people. It'll change who you relate with. The thing is, when we're not living life by purpose, we're going to live life by pleasure. And anytime we are driven by pleasure and not purpose, we will lead ourselves to our own demise, and most often we'll lead other people to theirs too. But the adverse effect is this, that if you live a life of purpose, you most likely are going to lead people to a place of destiny, and oftentimes they're going to experience a better life because you tapped into the reason why you are here. Each and every one of us have a unique purpose. I love how Ephesians 2:10 says this. It says, for we are his workmanship. I like in some versions says his masterpiece. Created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Like when God created you, you are magnificently molded, divinely designed, strategically shaped to make a difference. And when you were born, he already had your life written out. And it says, if you just follow me, you'll experience the greatest things. But we all have our moments of veering off the path. But I just want to remind some people today, I know you might not like exactly what the scales say about you, but your Savior has a better word for you, that you are created in his image with his purpose already on your heart. There's such a void that this world cannot fill, that anything you do, no matter how much money you make, no matter how much education you have, no matter how many people you relate with, that until you tap into the purposes of God and the identity in which he created you for, you will not be fulfilled. I remember heard Will Smith say this. He said, you know, I've had the privilege of making enough money to buy whatever I want. He said, I've done it. He says, now I wish other people had the same opportunity just to find out that it's not worth it, that it doesn't satisfy. Now, I had two responses to that statement. Why y'all laughing? The first response was like, wow, that sounds so much like Solomon, like so wise, Will. Like, it is not, you cannot buy happiness. And my other response was, I wouldn't mind trying it. I want to have that testimony. Like, look, I got all the stuff. I got the island. I got the mansion. I got 3 cyber trucks in different colors. I got big wheels on one, little wheels on the other. I got all the sneaker collection I could ever imagine. After all of that, it still does not bring glory to my happiness. But it definitely made Tuesday better. Okay. Our family has recently been going through a devotional, which if you have a family, I do highly recommend doing devotionals together. Just read it. You don't even have to be a scholar, because our children are often smarter spiritually than we are, because we've learned so much, we've gotten dumb. That was my sneaky way of calling it my... And so we're doing this devotional, and it was talking about family and mission, talking about God's mission. And so we start, it gives this very pithy and helpful statement about God's mission. God's mission is to be known and worshiped by people from every nation, tribe, and tongue. Very simple. God's mission is to be known and worshiped by people from every nation, tribe, and tongue. And you can follow this all throughout the Bible. In the book of Revelation, you have every nation, tribe, and tongue worshiping him. When you see God delivering the people or either calling forth Abraham, he said, all the nations will one day know me through you. And so we see this whole thing that God's mission is to be known and worshiped by people from every nation, tribe, and tongue. And if God's mission is that, that means our mission can't be much different. That we can have a specific way we state it, but at the end of the day, our mission is to help people know who God is and worship him in every nation, tribe, and tongue. Now, this goes continue in Acts 1:8, after Jesus has resurrected from the grave, that he comes and now he gives the disciples and his followers a word. He says, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. You shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all of Judea, Samaria, and to the end of the earth. The Christian life was never meant to be lived outside of mission. Because anytime the Christian life is lived outside of mission, we're living into consumerism, and it's about what we want and about what we get, and we're trying to make God in our image versus remembering that we were made in God's image. And too often, we have now sold a Christian faith where people get what they desire on this earth, but they lose sight that it's supposed to be for eternity and God's glory. And when we have a Christianity that's only about what I want, this means that the church becomes a convenience store where people come in and get goods and services as an exchange, but then they leave and they never change. One of my deep passions is that the church will reclaim its distinguished purpose, that we're not supposed to look like everybody else and sound like everybody else, because we're supposed to experience something different that makes our life not about us, but about the Lord, about his glory, and about his mission. And so when I look at this moment, this idea of being a witness, when you think about being a witness, if you're called into a court case as an eyewitness, this means you have experienced or either seen something that now you have to tell the truth about it. Notice Jesus didn't say, you're going to be my witnesses, and he did not give them a helper. The helper, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is eternal, which means Holy Spirit has been there since the beginning, was there at the crucifixion, was there at the resurrection, and now is inside of us. And so when somebody comes and asks us, how do you know that Jesus is real? Because I have an eternal living being, the Holy Spirit on the inside of me, that tells me that the word of Jesus, the life of Jesus is true. And so I just wanted somebody to know today that I know your earthly vessel is a temporary thing, but you're holding an eternal being in the Holy Spirit that's going to help you bear witness to the truth of Christ. And so you have been now given the power of the Holy Spirit that you might be a witness. So this is the moment that this is what makes worship and prayer so unique, because while you've only been existing in this earth for just a breath of a moment, that the Holy Spirit helps you tap in to the day when Jesus rose from the grave, that when you begin to pray, you begin to have a witness on the inside of you that says, if he conquered death, surely his mercies are new this morning. Surely his grace is sufficient. Surely he'll never leave you nor forsake you. The Holy Spirit bears witness to us of the things of eternity. So that when we speak to people, we can speak beyond just right now. And we can speak to them based on the things of eternity. So God's mission to be known and worshiped by people from every nation, tribe, and tongue now brings in our mission. I love this definition of biblical evangelism. Biblical evangelism means nothing less than the whole church bringing the whole gospel to the whole world. Biblical evangelism means nothing less than the whole church bringing the whole gospel to the whole world. And so the way we say it at our church, we want to be a witness in our location, vocation, and recreation through our tribulation and our celebration. And let me run that back to you, because I want you to have it, because this is going to be the thread and action point for you when you leave. That we are to be witnesses in our location, vocation, and recreation. Now, if you have an advanced degree, then you go to tribulation and celebration.
What I mean by this, in location where you live, your vocation where you work, your recreation where you play, all of these are platforms. If you wait to get here to preach, you've already missed your purpose. Let me say that again to this side. If you wait to get here to preach and you miss your location, vocation, and recreation to preach, you're already late on your purpose. In other words, when I look at this idea of being a witness in your location, vocation, and recreation, this is now us taking on the incarnation. And the incarnation is how Jesus wrapped himself in flesh and lived among us to bear witness to us of the things of the Father. And so when I look at the incarnation, Jake Thurston of Indiana Wesleyan University said it like this. In the incarnation, God became human to be with us. That's what allowed him to meet us right where we are and identify with our needs. Therefore, incarnational ministry is just that. It's actively being with those around you. It's actively being with those around you. Every member that comes to the church is a missionary. And so when you go to Starting Point here at TNLC, what we're really saying is we didn't want you to come to the church to fill a seat. We actually want you to come to church to be trained up and be sent out. And if every member is a missionary, we'll begin to see change. But we even, at our church, we actually changed the language from membership because what happens is, how many people have memberships to gyms that they don't go to? Like, gyms actually plan on having a large membership role. And if you look at the occupancy of their gym, the physical location, and their membership role, they do not have enough occupancy to fit all their members because they plan for some people just to pay their money but never utilize the facility. And so it's not enough just to be a member of a church. It's actually, we're called to be missionaries. Now, let me tell you a little bit about my burden. When I talk about this, is that I have an equal burden for the lost, the least, and the lazy. Yep. The lost, those who are going to bust hell wide open with gasoline draws on. Like, I realize I'm not at home. I'm a country boy from Virginia. And so every now and then, you know, we get hot as fish grease, you know. All right, so. And so I have a burden for the lost, for people who do not know Jesus, that are going to spend eternal damnation and separation. I have a burden for them. I have also a burden for the least of these, the widows, the orphans, those who are looked over, the people groups. And I want to celebrate just TNLC's, I think it's called a special needs ministry. Shine. It's Shine, right? And I want to celebrate. I have been watching that ministry for years. Almost longer before I knew Clayton personally, I said, if a church is going to do something significant in a community, this is what it's about. And so I want to celebrate. Matter of fact, y'all just celebrate a church, right, that cares about the least of these and creating that space. Because sometimes, you know, you ever think about when Jesus fed the 5,000? That the person who was like 2,076, when they got the fish sandwich, they probably was just thinking like, wow, man, it's free food today. They were so far from the miracle, they forgot that it was a miracle. So when you have a ministry like Shine and other efforts that you all are doing, I just want you, don't forget that it's a miracle. That it's an opportunity for you to serve, but also an opportunity for you to learn from a population that their joy is so much further than ours. And so, but I also have a burden for the lazy. And when I say lazy, these are the people who look at salvation as the get out of hell free card. That's all. I just want to be a Christian so I don't go to the hot place. Or either those who are so spiritually deep but do nothing with their faith. Some people are on the fence and some people are on the bench. For those who are on the bench, hopefully this will be a message to be able to get you off the bench and say, it's not enough just for me to come and just get what I want to get, but it's enough for me now to say, I have to get in the game. I've been playing sports all my life, and one of the most torturous things is be on the sideline. Even if it's a position you can't really play, it's like, look, I believe I can not throw an interception. This kicker had one job. Kick the ball through those big yellow things. That's all you do at practice. I'm over here getting concussions and broken arms. All you gotta do is kick the ball. All right, sorry. And so as we come to this moment of how do we get people mobilized in the mission of God and walking in the purposes of God, when I look at Matthew chapter 9, our focal text, I see this moment where Jesus, it says that he healed all of their diseases, right? He was teaching in the synagogues. He was going from the cities and the villages, preaching the gospel and the kingdom, healing every sickness and every disease among the people. And then in verse 36, it says, but when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them because they were weary and scattered like sheep having no shepherd. If you're taking notes, here's the first thing that we do in order to be sent ones. Recognize and agonize the problem. Recognize and agonize the problem. Jesus, again, getting in context, he's going around preaching. He's on a revival tour. Maverick City is no longer have not been made yet, and there's no elevation night, so it's just Jesus. Jesus goes from cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel, healing every sickness and every disease among the people. All right, I want to make sure you get this. He's preaching, he's teaching, he's healing every sickness and every disease among the people. Now, I only can imagine, as Jesus is doing this, verse 36, it says, but when he saw the multitudes, but when you read verse 35, he was traveling, preaching, teaching, healing every sickness and disease. In verse 36, he sees the multitude. There's more people who are sick, diseased, despondent, desperate, doubting, that need deliverance. And when he sees the multitudes, it's like his attention shifted. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them. It's not saying that he wasn't moved with compassion already. It actually just shows that he never got tired of working with the broken. But I can only imagine if you've ever been working outside or doing some labor and you think you have made, you've made a dent in your work and you just look up and you realize, it's like, anybody ever weeded like a mulch bed or a flower bed? And, you know, you bent down, you're getting it, your back hurt, and you're like, man, look at this. I've done all this. And you stand up and you look and say, okay, I've done nothing. I've done absolutely nothing. It's kind of like cleaning up your house with kids. You work so hard. You're like, yes, 9 o'clock, house is clean. 9:05, oh, my gosh. I've done nothing. Imagine Jesus, after doing all of this, he looks up. There's more sick. There's more people who need hope, who need help, who need healing. He was moved with compassion. He looked at them. He saw that they were weary and they were scattered like sheep having no shepherd. He saw they were vulnerable. These groups of people are the people that have been taken advantage of by their religious parties and their political parties. These are the people that were excommunicated because they had a disease that doctors could not fix. These are the people that were considered the least and the unlikely to be chosen to ever have any social status at all. The uneducated. He looks at them and he's moved with compassion. If you read your Bible, Jesus never looks at the Pharisees and is moved with compassion. Matthew chapter 9, earlier in that verse 12, when they asked Jesus, like, man, why are you among the sinners and the tax collectors? Because they had such an elitist mentality. They're like, why are you around the people that don't benefit you? He says, those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. but go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Jesus was moved with compassion because the people were deprived and disconnected. When you look at those who are deprived, when you think about depravity, it means to take something away, especially something that is usually considered essential for mental and physical well-being. Other words that match deprived are thrown down or downcast. And in our current society, there are people who are deprived. There are people who have less than. And we begin to look at everybody like everybody should be able to pull themselves up by their own bootstraps. But what happens when you don't have boots? What happens when you have already been deprived of things? What happens when children are already exposed to things that will begin to shape their mental, emotional, and relational ability before they even hit puberty? What happens when people already have trauma before they can have healthy memories? That these are people who are deprived like sheep without a shepherd. And even in this moment, Jesus looks up and he's still moved with compassion. We have to be able to recognize the issue and agonize over it. Two. I don't know when was the last time that you actually agonized over somebody's depravity. That when you come to the place that we must be a culture of righteous weepers, that when you see somebody in their depravity, that these are the moments that it should break your heart. I was just recently, I worked for a transitional facility when people come out of correctional facilities and they're trying to get reacclimated to society. This 90-day program was to help people develop relapse prevention plans and lower recidivism rates, which keep them from going back into the prison system. 95% of them dealt with some serious level of substance abuse. I came out of seminary, and this was the job that I got while I was planting the church. And so I'm working with convicted felons and those who deal with addiction. And what I realized is, as I'm talking to some folks, that they already had generations that had dealt with the addiction and dealt with incarceration. I remember sitting in a group therapy session, and I'm learning the ropes here because I didn't go to school to be a substance abuse counselor. But now I'm learning and I'm seeing the very same things in substance abuse as we see as in sin. We all are addicts and we all need the higher power, which is God, to be able to be able to bring us back to a place of sanity. And then as I'm listening to this man talk, and this man was about 50 years old at the time, and he said, look, I gave the state my 20s. I gave the state my 30s, I gave the state my 40s, and I'm trying my best not to give the state my 50s. In other words, this man had been locked up for 30 years on and off. And he's trying to figure out how to break the cycle. Now here it is, he's a grandparent, and his son is going in the same track. When was the last time you recognized and agonized over somebody else's depravity? Because without the agonizing, you're not going to keep going. Jesus agonized over their pain, and he saw them like sheep without a shepherd. There's another text in Luke where he looked over the people and says that Jesus wept. Jesus only cried two times in the Bible. One time when he looked over people that were deprived, that were disconnected, and the other time was when his friend Lazarus died. If lost people, hurting people can cause Jesus to cry, and Jesus was the solution. What must we do for our hearts to be set ablaze again? To recognize and agonize the depravity in which people are living in. When I look at this and I look at those who are disconnected, he says they were scattered like sheep with no shepherd. Now, my father, I watched three things with my father: sports, Westerns, and National Geographic. I know it's a pretty wicked manly combination there. But we watched National Geographic, and that was the only thing I remember when Animal Planet came out. Come on, let's age myself. But you know, the gazelle or either the prey that always was most vulnerable was the one that was separated from the flock or separated from the herd. When Jesus saw these folks, he said they're scattered like sheep without a shepherd. And sheep, the only ability that they have to survive is by sticking together. And so what Satan constantly does is try to separate people. That's why relationships are so hard. And so he constantly tries to separate people so we can be scattered. And so what I'm saying is there are people that are scattered. They might seem anxious. They might seem angry. They might seem apathetic. But really is, they're scattered. They don't know how to be connected with a people group that can help them survive. And so when Jesus looked at them as scattered, he looked at them as, here's a couple things for you. They were harassed. They were helpless. They were hopeless. They were hapless. I don't know if you ever heard the word hapless. Hapless is an interesting word. That means unlucky and unfortunate. You just feel unlucky and unfortunate all the time. And some of y'all hapless today. I'm like, if it's bad, it's going to get worse. But they were hurt, and they were hungering for help. When Jesus looked at these people, he was moved with compassion. Here's one of my prayers today, is that compassion will come back to us. Because when you look at the climate over the last few years in our culture, one thing that we lost, we can differ in political opinions, we can differ in how people carry out social justice, we can differ in how people carry out things in the education system, but the issue in our differing was we lost compassion for one another. And when you lose compassion, what happens is you begin to dehumanize other people, and when you dehumanize other people, you always make them the issue for the problem that they have. The reason why you end what you end is because you did what you did. It's just like we begin to be Pharisees all over again. Remember they looked at the blind man, the disciples looked at the blind man in John chapter 9, I believe. They said, who sinned? Him or his parents? I know one of them sinned. And Jesus said, neither sinned. This happened for the glory of God to be revealed. But when you lose compassion, you lose the capacity to be able to get a revelation of what God might be doing. So what do you do when you recognize and agonize the problem? Matthew 9:36 is when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion. This means now he's going to respond. And he says, then he turns to his disciples in verse 37. He says, then he said to his disciples, the harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. So watch, he sees it. He's the only one that sees the issues. No, the disciples, they were like roadies. Y'all know what roadies are? Roadies are those who follow around the band with the hopes one day maybe to get on stage or either get a groupie. So they just walking around like, wow, look at this. They don't see the problem. They just caught up in the spotlight. Jesus sees the multitude, and then he turns to the disciples. Because you got to see in the moment, he sees the multitudes. He's been healing. He's been preaching. He's been teaching. And he sees the multitudes scattered like sheep without a shepherd. He's moved with compassion, and he turns to the disciples. Teachable moment. He says, hey, y'all, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. There's an issue. The math ain't mathing. That's how we say it. He said, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Now you need to pray to the Lord of the harvest. It's not for you just to jump out here and do it in your own strength. You need to pray to the Lord of the harvest so that he can send out the laborers. Because the harvest is not yours. The harvest is the Lord's. So we need to see as Jesus saw, feel as Jesus felt, so that we can do as Jesus did. How do we respond to the problem? We got to see the hope. The harvest is truly plentiful. Jesus could have looked at them and just said, okay, well, that's a lost cause. But he looked at broken people and said, you know what? I'm going to build a future off of them. Is anybody in here glad that Jesus looks at you in your hapless place, in your hopeless place, in your helpless place, and still sees hope for your future? He still sees that he can make something out of nothing. His grace is sufficient. And right where they were broken, he began to build. I want somebody to be encouraged today. Don't be ashamed of your brokenness. Your brokenness is the building material that Jesus is going to use to be able to bring a testimony to many people in the future. You're not broken. You're being built. In other words, his grace is going to secure you and make you stable in the midst of your weakness. And so as I look at this moment, Jesus saw the hope. The harvest is plentiful. Oh, family, we got to recognize if your county and if your city surrounding area, when you look at the amount of unchurched people, and not just the unbelievers, when you look at the amount of unchurched people, we need more churches in the area. We need bigger buildings so people can come in and sit. Because guess what? We have so many people who are scattered like sheep without a shepherd. And God has given you now first dibs to this hope, to this taste of heaven, so you can go now and be a waiter and a waitress and go and serve this everywhere you go, in your location where you live, in your neighborhood, in your recreation where you play, in your vocation where you work, because somebody needs to know that the gospel still works. Is there anybody in here that believes the gospel still works, that still believe that Jesus still saves, he still heals, he still delivers? And so as I look at this, Jesus says, now you got to see the hope, but now you got to ask for the help to be sent. You got to report the problem. You got to report the problem in prayer. As Pastor Clayton said, in this fall, in this fall fast, when you guys begin to fast and pray, you're getting ready for a harvest to come back into play. When you come in, this means when you're fasting and you're praying, you're believing that some of those that were scattered like sheep without a shepherd, they're going to come in and they're going to begin to experience the goodness of God in the land of the living. And so when you turn down your plate, when you turn down your social media, when you turn down your pleasures, when you begin to turn your face towards God, this is you saying, God, the harvest is plentiful, the laborers are few, send out the laborers. There are people in our school system, there are people in our medical systems, there are people in our education system that need to know that Jesus is still at work. I want y'all to be on fire for reaching the lost. I want y'all to be on fire for getting the lazy off the bench. I want y'all to be on fire for getting those who are on the fence, getting them off the fence and fully involved with the mission of God. Is there anybody in here that believes that God is still at work, that believes that the harvest is plentiful and there's about to be a revival? As I look at this moment, family, I want to encourage you, be like the woman at the well. While the disciples went to go get food for Jesus, she had an encounter with Jesus in John chapter 4. And as she had this encounter with Jesus, Jesus told her everything about her. She had some relational issues. She was outcast. And she went back to the very place that she was shamed. She went back to the city of Samaria and told all the men about the man that she just met. They already heard her testimony. It's like, you met another man. Okay. But no, she said, this one's different. This one is the Savior of the world. Whole city came to hear Jesus preach. And when they heard Jesus preach, they said, no longer do we believe just because of what you said, but we have heard it ourselves. Do you know the best thing, the best marketing tool, the best evangelism tool that you could ever have is a transformed life? So whatever God has done in your life, go and tell the story. There's two people that want to use your history. If Satan uses your history, it's going to be condemnation. But if God uses your history, it's going to be testimony that's going to bring life to many, many others. We survive by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. So here's my hope, that we could be incarnational missionaries everywhere you go, everywhere you play. Even if you're going through your tribulation, your trial, you might be on your sick bed, you might be going through a grieving situation, but there's somebody who's grieving like those who don't have hope. But you have hope. And so you can bring hope to hopeless situations. I want to pray for us this morning. Father, we thank you so much for who you are. Lord, we thank you for this time and this opportunity. And God, I pray, Lord, that you will light a fire in our spirit. That we will see that the harvest truly is plentiful. That there are people who are lost. There are people who are less than how people look at them. They don't look at them like God's creation. There are people who are lazy, and you called us to fan the flame, to spark the flame, to ignite a new movement. So God, I pray for Trinity and all the ways you're going to mobilize them to make a difference in this world through your good news. So God, we join into your mission. We know participation is better than observation. So may you be known and worshiped by every people, nation, tribe, and tongue. In your name we pray. Amen and amen.
Amen.